Today, I would like to look through the parameters that you need to set to record a cyclic voltammogram. Most people that do electrochemistry will sooner or later do a cyclic voltammogram, so I thought it's useful to look in PSTrace what each of the parameters actually mean. Let's have a look in PSTrace. And if you want to perform cyclic voltammetry, just connect your potentiostat, select cyclic voltammetry, and you get the mask to set all the parameters. To easier explain all the different parameters, I have prepared some slides that we're going to have a look at right now. So let's start with something easy, with the current range. So the current range, you can imagine like a scale on a map. So let's look at these two maps. So we have a scale bar here at the bottom right, and we first have a scale bar of 50 meters. And that means we can clearly see that PalmSens is in this building at the Randhuve, and it's not, for example, here where this church is. But we cannot see any of the neighboring cities of Houten where we're located. If we zoom out and have a scale bar of 5 kilometers, we can nicely see that Utrecht and Zeist are around the corner. But we can no longer see properly in which street we would be located. I mean, we see we're not here in the south of Houten, but we don't see in which street. And this is how the current range works. So if your current range is selected too high, you don't get a proper resolution for your measurement. If it's set too low, then the current cannot go to the values that it would need to go to. So let's have a look at the next parameter. Oh yes, for the current range, there is this little triangle. I don't know if everybody has noticed it at some point. The triangle tells you where you start. So which current range is your starting current range? All the blue current ranges are available for outer ranging. So the potentiostat will try to select between these current ranges the one that is best for your measurement. And the triangle indicates the current range that is the one where the measurement starts. Okay, let's look at the next parameter, and that is the T equilibration. And this is a waiting time with the starting potential. So we apply the E begin, the starting potential, and do not record anything. Why would you want to have it? There are two advantages of setting an T equilibration. So one of them is the just mentioned outer ranging. So for example, if you start a measurement and you don't know if you have selected the best starting current range for it, you can have a bit of T equilibration, and every half second the potentiostat will switch the current range. So this way you can give the potentiostat a bit of time to find the right current range. Another reason is a more chemical one, and that is when you make a potential step from your system, let's say in this case away from the OCP to your E begin, you induce a capacitive current, and you're not really interested in your capacitive current. So by waiting a few seconds, most parts of the capacitive current have already decayed. As you can see here in the small cartoon, the capacitive current decays exponentially, and we know our Faraday currents decay with 1 divided by square root of T. So that takes longer. Okay, the next parameters are all potentials, and that is the E begin, so where does the measurement start? And then the two vertex potentials. And these are the two potentials where we change the scan rate for our cyclic voltammogram. And changing the scan rate just means you go from plus to minus or minus to plus, so you just change the direction. And this little cartoon shows this here. So you go from the E begin to the first vertex potential, and then with the same slope into the other direction. So you just change from plus to minus here. And then you go again to the vertex potential, and when you then reach again the E begin, you've complete a full cycle or scan. Right, so these three potentials then define in which potential range are you scanning your CV. The next one, the E step, tells you the resolution of your CV. So actually, Our potentiostats are digital potentiostats. That means they cannot have a perfect continuum. They work with little steps to change the potential. So your ramp is not a perfect line. It is actually just a small series of steps. And how high these steps are can be defined with a step potential. Right? So we see here when you change the potential in a linear fashion, actually these are little steps. And how high these are is the E step. That also means when is a point recorded. That means we have now an E step of 5 millivolts. That means every 5 millivolts you would record a point with the current value. Okay, the next one is the scan rate, and that is of course a very important parameter for the cyclic voltammetry because it determines the time frame of the experiment. So it tells you how fast the potential is changing. This is why the unit is volts per second. So here we see different scan rates, and this is on the x-axis we have the time, and on the y-axis we have the potential. And of course, the higher the scan rate, the quicker the potential will change over time, right? So the lowest scan rate, oh, this should be a yellow, of course, then you see that this is the lowest scan rate. So the scan rate is basically the slope of your potential sweep. Okay, then the last basic parameter is the number of scans. And I just talked about like how you go from the E begin to the vertex one, vertex two, and back to the E begin. That's a complete scan. And if you want, you can repeat this multiple times. So this is, for example, interesting to test how stable your system is, if your system is changing. It's interesting for people who do modify a system with cyclic voltammetry. Let's say you're depositing a polymer, for example, to just watch it over multiple cycles. Okay, so these are the standard parameters. There are in PSTrace a few more parameters that I would like to show you real quick. And these are special parameters that are hidden under the advanced options button. The advanced options button sounds very fancy, but it's just these three points here. You click them and you get a few more options. One of them are criteria for reversing. So let's say you don't know where at which potential you want to reverse, but you know you want a certain current for reversing. Then you can just check these options and select a current at where you want to reverse. Then we have the option to, instead of using the reference electrode, so you having all potentials versus the reference electrode, you can actually select that for some of the potentials, you will use the OCP as a reference. That means right before the measurement, there will be a small OCP measurement, and then that will be used as the zero value for the potentiostat. You can also set which potentials will be used against the OCP, and you can set how long you want to measure the OCP before the measurement starts, or which criteria needs to be met, so how far can it vary still. Then you can also set various triggers at certain points of the measurements. And the triggers just mean you set the digital lines from the auxiliary port of your potentiostat. You set these to certain values, and you can use that to communicate to other devices. So let's say, for example, you have maybe a flow system, and then when you start the measurement, you want to start the flow. So you could give your pump a signal that it should start the measurement now. And now I've thoroughly covered like all the parameters for cyclic voltammetry, and I hope that will help you perform all the measurements that you need for your research. If you like this video and you want to see more, you can visit our YouTube channels and maybe you also subscribe to it. Don't forget to follow us on LinkedIn because we also post there if we have new videos. So thanks for watching and have a great day.